Procedures shown may not be current or airline specific. Do not use for real-life flying. Once again, we find ourselves cruising at 36,000 feet. When suddenly the master caution light illuminates and the cabin altitude warning lights, along with an intermittent horn. The pilot flying then states,
"My aircraft."
The dashes in the altitude windows reveal a pressurization issue, and we can see the cabin pressure is decreasing. We must take immediate action and don our oxygen masks. We then speak to each other, which confirms our masks are on, and we can still hear and speak with each other. An emergency is declared to ATC, as an immediate descent is anticipated and priority will be required. The pilot flying calls for the rapid depressurization checklist. Depending on airline, if applicable, the quick reference card is scanned for the first steps of the checklist, then the quick reference handbook is used. Owing to the time critical importance of this checklist, the rapid depressurization checklist is listed on the first page of the QRH in the quick action list in large bold text that can be read even with a full face oxygen mask on. The same checklist can also be found under cabin altitude warning, since this is the wording on the two illuminated warning lights. As with all non-normal checklists, the pilots must agree the correct checklist is about to be used. The title and condition are read by the pilot monitoring, and the pilot flying must agree before it is continued. This would sound like,
"Cabin altitude warning or rapid depressurization checklist, condition, one or more of these occur, a cabin altitude exceedance in flight, the intermittent gain altitude configuration warning horn sounds and the cabin altitude lights have installed and operative illuminate. Do you agree?"
"I agree."
The first two steps were completed as memory items, the oxygen masks were donned and the regulators set to 100%, and by speaking to each other, crew communication was established. With a loss of cabin pressure, the time of useful consciousness without supplemental oxygen is short. For example, at 35,000 feet, the time of useful consciousness after a rapid depressurization is only 15 to 30 seconds. Step 3 directs the pressurization mode selector to be switched to manual mode. Step 4 has the outflow valve switch held in the close position until the outflow valve is fully closed. This is an attempt to seal the airplane and stop further loss of cabin pressure. The outflow valve is located on the fuselage below the right horizontal stabilizer. It modulates between open and closed to control the pressure of the cabin by venting pressurized air supplied by the packs to maintain the desired cabin pressure. Before continuing, let's rewind and take a closer look at what has occurred. We were at 36,000 feet with a cabin pressure of 6,000 feet. The differential pressure was 8.4 psi. Immediately cabin pressure was lost, the cabin altitude rapidly increased, while differential pressure quickly decreased. The cabin rate of climb indicator needle is at maximum rate of climb, showing a cabin pressure climb rate of at least 400 feet per minute. The flight altitude and landing altitude boxes now display dashes. Above them, the autofail light indicates an excessively high cabin altitude. As cabin pressure starts to reach the outside air pressure, the rate of cabin altitude climb slows down, and the cabin altitude needle indicates the cabin is at the aircraft's altitude. When all pressure is lost, the differential pressure is zero, and the cabin no longer climbs. Even when the outflow valve has been closed, we can see no differential pressure, the cabin altitude matches the aircraft's altitude, and the aircraft has depressurized. Step 5 is conditional. If the cabin altitude is not controllable, we complete the step, otherwise continue to step 6. As we just saw, the aircraft has depressurized and we have no control, even with the outflow valve closed. We therefore turn on the passenger signs, as directed. The next action depends if the cabin altitude exceeds or is expected to exceed 14,000 feet. We know the cabin altitude is at 36,000 feet, and therefore turn on the passenger oxygen switch. The checklist now states to go to the emergency descent checklist. The four black boxes underneath indicate the cabin altitude warning or rapid depressurization checklist itself has been completed. Once again, the pilots must concur that the correct checklist is about to be used. The pilot monitoring states the checklist title and reads the condition, asking the pilot flying if they agree this is the correct checklist before continuing. A PA is then made by the pilot flying.
Cabin crew, rapid descent, rapid descent.
The pilot monitoring sets 7700 on the transponder, advises ATC of the descent, and obtains the area altimeter setting. The passenger signs are confirmed on, and without delay a descent is made to the lowest safe altitude, or 10,000 feet, whichever is higher. A level change descent mode will provide an idle descent. The next step is to turn both engine start switches to continuous ignition, and then reduce thrust to minimum or as needed for anti-ice. A note states that the autopilot and auto throttle should remain engaged. The speed brake is moved to the flight detent, and if structural integrity is not in doubt, the target speed set to MMO or VMO to maximize the rate of descent. Structural integrity may be gauged by indicators such as vibration, noise, or reports from the flight attendants. Had the integrity been in doubt, the speed would be limited and high maneuvering loads avoided. As the aircraft rapidly descends towards 10,000 feet, there is much that can be done. The flight attendants should be contacted to find out how the passengers and crew are doing and to brief the plan of action and time to landing. If an immediate landing is to be made, weather can be obtained through the FMC, the likely approach setup, and a message sent to the dispatcher, letting them know of the emergency and plan of action. The dispatcher can send a multitude of information, including note TAMs at the airport. When the aircraft approaches the level off altitude, the speed brake can be moved to the down detent and thrust added to stabilize altitude and airspeed. The crew oxygen regulators can be moved to the normal position to conserve oxygen. Step 10 informs that the engine start switches may now be set as needed. The final step is some guidance on creating a new course of action based on weather, oxygen, fuel remaining, and available airports. It also indicates the use of long-range crews may be needed. The four black boxes indicate the checklist has been completed, and the pilot monitoring states to the pilot flying.
Emergency descent checklist complete.
Please subscribe to learn of future videos, when we'll cover more non-normal procedures. Thank you.